this panel discussion is important for all of us who are concerned and involved in the Indian defense sector. And we have a kind of a full spectrum representation here because we have an Indian OEM, a leading Indian original equipment manufacturer in L&T, and Mr. Patel is a very experienced, as you heard, defense practitioner, defense industry practitioner. General Hasafnis has been in the process of acquisition, has tenanted a couple of appointments, very, very important appointments, and right now he is also the deputy chief in charge of capital acquisitions for the Indian Army. Mr. Jaju, as you heard, is a mechanical engineer and also very passionate about IT, has done tremendous work in his parent cadre back home, but in the defense ministry, he is the points person for exports. And as you are aware, in the last couple of years, the exports of Indian defense products and equipment has grown exponentially, and one of the key persons responsible for that is Mr. Jaju, so I'm glad to have him here. Kurt is, of course, with Lockheed Martin, which has a big presence in India, and they are hoping to have bigger presence as years go along. And as you can see, he is in charge of the F-21 program. I wish, besides him, I wish my old friend Vivek Lal was here, but he's caught up in some other meeting in the MOD. Nevertheless, let me begin with Sanjay Jaju, because he is in charge of exports and encouraging exports of Indian defense equipment. How do you see the future for the Indian defense industry, and especially in the field of exports and trying to help for friendly foreign countries, both in the neighborhood and in the extended neighborhood? What are your plans and what is your hope?
I'm pretty sanguine about the prospects, because I mean, the fact is that we as a nation are now slowly emerging as a defense manufacturing hub. And it's an imperative. I mean, a country of our size and a country with our kinds of problems, I mean, I'm talking about the strategic problems, cannot afford to not have strategic independence when it comes to military supplies and equipments. So it's good that now we are slowly coming of age, and it's kind of reflected in our journey over the last 2 years, from a paltry $200 million to close to $1.4 billion. And when I say $1.4 billion is what we permit under this moment. But there are a large number of items which actually get exported out of our country where they don't require our permission. I may not even have the data for it. So, when it comes to the prospects, if you are looking at a $25 billion defense and aerospace economy by 2024, obviously exports will have to contribute close to $5 billion. I mean, not just for the sake of these numbers, but it's an imperative, because once you start exporting, then you actually become part of the global supply chains. You also become, and you've got to be competitive, because eventually you have to give a value for money to your customers. So to an extent, this is a game which most of the countries have played, most of the big companies have played, and that's how they become competitive, that's how they become world leaders, and I think that's where we're looking at our companies. Good thing is that there are some players who have also understood the value of exports. I mean, I'm not too sure, say 2 years back, the top manufacturers sitting right here, and all of them are actually looking only at Indian market, so as to say. And the only notion that used to be given to me when I joined this department close to 2 years back was, Indian Army or the Indian Forces services are not buying, so what do we do? How do we export? But I think now there is a spring in the stride. There is that confidence that, look, Indian Forces have also got their own limitations. You have limited budgets, you have competing demands, so it's not as if they are not able to buy, your product is substandard. Your product is world standard. The only thing is there are some competing demands which takes time. So now our private sector especially, and some of our public sector companies also, all of them have realized that exports is the way forward. Not just for improving the kind of products that they have, but also try and differentiate their products, also to try and build their brand up. And that kind of a thing is happening. I mean, last 2 years I have seen many of our companies have ventured out, going out into the world and displaying their product, demonstrating, trying to make use of the lines of credit that are also being given out to many countries. And to an extent, that's going to be an important factor when it comes to bringing our products up. Yeah. As a department also, I think there was that agility which was required in this department, to be very honest with you. I mean, when you're looking at an international market, people are applying for authorizations and you give them authorizations in say 8 months, in 6 months, in 4 months, how are they going to compete in the world? I mean, there's the world is a common global market. There are people not waiting only for our products. There are large range of products. So I think that red tape had to be cut down. And to an extent, we have done that. Something that used to take say 70 days is now just taking 30 days. In components, something that was taking close to 35 days is now just taking less than a week. And now we are also shortly coming up with two open general export licenses, one for the components and one for the intra-company transfer. It's going to happen possibly in this week. And once that happens, to an extent, we'll again become much more, as they call it, customer friendly or technically client friendly. Ease of doing export business will get further enhanced. Something also which has happened is our entry into the multilateral forums like Wassenaar and stuff. So when it happens, the world will start looking at you, and we've always been very responsible because we've never been exporting. But now they also look at us as a responsible exporting nation. We know about the protocols, we know about the safeguards that are required, and everything that we clear from the ministry actually is done through a process of complete diligence. So we are completely sure about who the end user is. We are ensuring that it doesn't get into the wrong hands, and in some of these things do help and contribute. But I am absolutely sanguine about our prospects. The only thing that I still perceive, which again will have to be now done, last 2 years our exports have broadly been components. I think what is now important is for our players to start looking at exporting platforms, because that's what is going to give the big buck. I mean, I was in a meeting yesterday with the US OEM, and they were saying a lot of exports happening from India to US, and you know, I said my problem is I export a component of a million, and then suddenly you will export to me something which is 1 billion. So now I have to make energy, I have to make efforts which is for close to 1,000 times of what you have done. So my numbers are never going to match your numbers. If I have to get those numbers, I need to get platforms going out of the country, and I am absolutely sure that now our companies have some platforms which have not just been tested for the Indian military, which have not just been purchased for the Indian military, but are actually world class, cost competitive, and as well as they are going to give the value for money for the world customers.
So thank you for being very candid about what the MOD also needs to do. But on that note, because you just mentioned that some platforms need to get exported, let me ask Mr. Patil, because L&T is one of the leading companies which is looking outward, as well as of course being a major supplier to the Indian Armed Forces. How do you look at the prospects of the Indian defense industry as a whole, and parts of that as exports, defense exports?
Let me start with the export, because that's a dramatic story. If I look at last 20 years, more or less, give away a year here or there, since the licensing actually happened, first 5 years, Larsen & Toubro was actually exporting, but the export values used to be below crore.
Crore rupees.
Individual orders typically used to be below crore. That's a period, first 5 years. At the same time, on the indigenous side, that was a period at which we just started receiving the first of the RFPs. There was no direct MOD order on any private sector happening. So from that 5 year, if I move into the next 5 year phase, and that's the reason of dividing it into those four phases, 2010-11, by the time we ended with that, the export order started getting into millions.
Right.
From rupee crore to $1 million. From there on, if we were to look at what was happening on Indian front, there was sizable amount of orders being placed, but we are still below 5%.
Okay.
So the total segment, whatever MOD would order in a given year, if you were to look at that, less than 5% was coming to private sector.
Okay.
Move on to the third phase. The exports actually fell right up to 2013-14. And the whole of the nation, if we look at, typically we had reached about 900, 950 crore, we fell down to 300 crores. From 300 crores as a national export, today from 14 onwards, if we were to look at, it today is into the best number to the last digit, of course,
1.4 billion.
Raju will sell precisely, yeah. So it's more than 11,000 crores. So the scenario we have seen with that is, a million became tens of million, and today it's hundreds of million.
That's right.
So the single contracts today one is able to pick up from the global market has started becoming, you know, truly have seen that kind of an exponential growth, and so is the indigenous opportunities. Today, I would say out of the AONs which have been on ground, competitive processes if we were to apply, nothing less than 35% of the entire acquisition in future, which we see today, nothing less than 15 to 16 billion, lakh of crores. Out of that, at least 35% is certainly going to be in a competitive mode, although much more is in the indigenous basket.
Right.
So, direct opportunity being allowed to private sector, it's a sea change. Ask me how much is physically converted. We can talk sometime down the line.
Yes.
Physical conversion as of today, obviously all of us know, has been seeing a huge amount of pressures on availability of money. But as some of those issues start getting addressed, we actually see a scenario completely different. So on export front, if I have to look at, you actually see today countries at those few hundred million dollar ticket items, they obviously are looking at certain amount of support coming. Prime Minister very clearly said, look east, go to the east. If we had to look east and act east, lot of east actually needs some amount of support. At the same time, there are many countries in this area who are prepared to actually get into a direct cash purchase.
Right.
Here's the money, you give me something. At the same time, I must say, we also have experiences that there are countries who are actually talking of complete from first RFP to the contract signing happening in 3 months.
Oh wow.
So, in our own neighborhood, few hours of flying out, literally you can do a travel today and tomorrow you're back kind of a scenario. We actually see efficiency of buying, which obviously there's not much we can imbibe within the country out of that.
The good practices of
and
those.
That's countries. Essentially where what Sanjay Raju said, actually makes a huge difference. If there's a process by which we actually get a clearance faster,
right.
Here's an opportunity for us to go out and get that deal that much faster. There are deals which actually will look for certain amount of financial aid and support. Obviously, as an evolving country, we have to find methods to deal with. Obviously, we clearly have an Exim support, but Exim support comes at a much, much higher cost.
Yes.
If you are truly competing in the international arena, we can't compete at Indian borrowing rate,
right.
Nor at Exim rate and be competitive. So there, yes. There are issues we need to be able to deal with, but at the same time, we actually see that going up.
Yes.
So for someone who's been in the defense exports, from a very small to a some sizable amount of today it's countable, let me say, let it balance,
it's count. Counts.
Earlier it was not counting, because below percent, you don't even count.
It was negligible, yes.
It was negligible. So, if with that kind of a scenario, it starts becoming something significant, it requires a specific attention,
right.
It requires a policy attention, and of course, huge amount of support from Ministry of Defense today in terms of clearance. Today, first opportunity you hear about something,
yes.
You are allowed to get into an export clearance, and at that stage when it's a little hazy, MOD is prepared to look at it.
Right.
Processes have been dramatically simplified, mm-hmm. And that's exactly the success story we see. So I see from 2013, from 300 crore to today's 11,000 crore, is a massive,
absolutely
exponential kind of growth.
Yes.
And it's always, one says that get the animal spirits of the industry going. you need a great policy support and a great team to support that.
And you are prepared to do that as Indian OEM.
That's exactly where we see. Today's ministry and industry both are in unison on export.
Right.
Scenario internal is a little different. It will still take some more time by the time our minds
change. Yeah, we will talk about that. But let me, with that, let me come to the Deputy Chief of the Indian Army, Lieutenant General Hasabnis, because he is in a very important post which determines what can be bought and what should be bought for the Indian Army. So in that sense, what changes do you see that have occurred over the last couple of years, and what do you think that the Indian industry must do to meet the requirements of the Indian Army?
Firstly, one of the most important changes that has taken place, to which the chief also alluded to, was the transparency in the requirements that the armed forces have that has come about in the last couple of years. I'm sure Mr. Patil will now get fed up when I recount this, because this you've shared this thought for some time now. That just about 2.5-3 years ago, if I was to read what we call as the technology perspective and capability roadmap, I myself wouldn't have been able to decipher as to what exactly did the armed forces want the industry to focus on in the years to come. But in 2018, we have now spelled out a very detailed and a very deliberate TPCR, as we call it, technology roadmap, which spells out specifics of not just the equipment in terms of numbers, but also the capabilities that are expected out of those technologies that we are looking at. That's one major change which I feel should enthuse the industry to start working towards developing technologies to meet the requirements of the armed forces. The other aspect about these were probably the higher end technologies. We have also come out with a large plethora of problem statements, problem definition statements that have been given out, all available on the internet. All three services have got this spelled out. There is something called challenges in the IDEX, which have been again put out onto the net. The very idea of sharing what we need with the industry was, I would like to believe, anathema a few years ago. This transparency, I'm sure, is something which will enable not just the industry to by themselves understand, but our reach out of all the three services to the entire stakeholder paradigm, whether it is academia, whether it is industry, the number of engagements that today the armed forces are involved in with the academia or with the industry is something which is a dramatic change over the last few months, if not a couple of years plus. So that's one very major difference that has come about in the way the armed forces are approaching the capability development paradigm. And we are sure that with the partnership that we are getting into with the academia and industry, it's only a matter of time that we should get homegrown technologies and capabilities to support us to deliver the on our missions that we have been given.
Great. In fact, that visibility that you spoke about, that you give it to the industry, that what is required in the future and the challenges that you face, is perhaps what enthuses the industry and the Indian defense manufacturers. But there is also this thing that everything cannot be done by the Indian manufacturer, and that's where I want to bring in Kurt here, that big OEMs and foreign OEMs like Lockheed Martin, how can they take the Indian defense industry to the next level? What can you contribute to India's defense growth?
So I would like to start that off with a little bit about some of the background, some of the history with Lockheed Martin. We have delivered aircraft around the world from foreign companies, 5 different locations around the world. When we go into those countries and we look for capabilities, try to understand which industries can build aircrafts, our model is based on going out and sampling the industry, understanding what their strengths are, understanding what their weaknesses are. Every company has strengths, every company has weaknesses. So what we look for is how do we utilize the strengths and how do we expand or stretch that company's capabilities to enhance their weaknesses so they're a well-rounded company. As an example, here in India, as we are looking at F-21 and trying to build an ecosystem here, we have done a desktop review of over 400 companies here in India, assessing their strengths, and we rank them, prioritize them. Of those 400 companies, we've actually gone on site visits to over 200 of those companies and basically go through and ask them a set of questions to understand their capabilities, understand what they are doing today, what do they look in the future, what is their growth plan, and then we look for how does that match what Lockheed Martin is looking for. Because when we want to get into a relationship with a company, it is not for one project. We look for the long term. And so I'll give you a couple of examples of those long term arrangements we have with different companies. So the first example I'd like to point out is KAI, Korea Aerospace Industries. They started by building components for the F-16 and eventually enhance their capability where they could build and deliver F-16s directly from their site. We grew that also to collaborate with them and work on a trainer. We jointly developed the T-50 trainer with KAI, and today we have a program going on in Korea that is called KFX, which is very similar to the AMCA project here in India. So that relationship started with just building a component, and now it is growing to delivering a trainer, and it is growing to developing their next generation of fighter for the Korean aerospace. And other examples in Europe. We have worked with companies that were building F-16 components and eventually grew to the capability to actually deliver the airplanes. And now we're actually working with them on F-35, and they're delivering F-35 components. So our model is based on how does that company fit into working with Lockheed Martin, and where do we see the future, and how do we grow that relationship? Because it takes time, and it is not beneficial to anyone if you build a one and done. You have to look for the future, you have to look for projects that stretch the capabilities of the companies to grow them to where they become capable of doing more work.
I'll come back to you on what you expect from the Indian MSME sector, for instance, but let me turn again to Sanjay Jaru. You have the Def Expo coming up in 2-3 months now in Lucknow. What's going to be the focus, and you know, you talked about ease of doing business in a way. But if I see some of the experiences of the Indian companies, Indian MSMEs, they feel that there should be little more encouragement for exports through, because Exim Bank, although you're providing credit, or if you have the line of credit to some of the friendly countries, there is some gap between what is your intention at the MOD and what is our embassy, let's say, in Central Asian Republics or Southeast Asian countries, whether they understand the importance of that letter of credit for defense. How do you overcome that perception gap, maybe, but that gap exists, that which exists?
I'll come to the couple of things that you've asked, and let me start with the lines of credit part. Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, the lines of credit were available, but if you look at the utilization, you won't find much. primarily because, you know, then this whole process was, let's say for example a company like L&T goes and figures out the specifications with a particular importing country, and then they come to us and say that look, lines of credit could be extended. Then you do a lines of credit, then they say we'll issue an expression of interest, then everybody will participate, and then ultimately the whole process was like, the price discovery process itself was taking so much time that by the time we reach the end stage, possibly the patience of the importing country would be completely exhausted, and they would realize that the bureaucracy in this country is like where that is. But now one significant development and change that has happened is, if a particular company has sold a similar product to our forces, now then we know the price. Now then we know the price, so we can use that price and provide an LOC. So this one significant improvement that has happened possibly over the last 3 months should help many of these LOCs getting sorted out. That is point one. Number two is, it's coming from the conversation that you were having with them, because you know my earlier experience was I used to be in information technology. I used to be secretary of the unified Andhra Pradesh state, and there I realized one thing. You know, how is it that our companies, I mean, for example, we never pleaded with a Lockheed Martin that look, rope in the players here and bring them into your supply chain. When it came to a Google or a Facebook or a Microsoft, they naturally came to India. Nobody pleaded with them. They realized that there is value for money, there is talent available. This country is not just the talent, there is an arbitrage available. You can do things at almost 10% of the cost that you could do in a Bay Area. And then you realize that these companies all gravitated. In Hyderabad you have, I think I've been telling this, and it's a fact that any product that you use right now anywhere in the world has an Indian coder somewhere sitting either in Bangalore or in Hyderabad or in the Bay Area or in that particular country. So effectively, you know, this realization is now going to come into this sector as well, that it is cheaper, it's value for money for bigger OEMs to come and set up shop in India. I mean, we have a huge demographic dividend. We are the only country in the world who's going to supply you technically qualified manpower with the number of engineers that we have, with the kind of competition that we have in engineering stream. You will have, and with the number of people even who are doing businesses, business courses in this country, and the progress of information technology and the next generation warfare is not going to be around conventional means. I mean, it's all going to be powered by, I'm not even going to artificial intelligence, it is going to be powered by all Internet of Things. There will be all smart ammunitions, smart arms, going down to the artificial intelligence. So that's where the progress of India is going to be. The OEMs would have to invariably come to India if they have to produce some of those stuff. And I think that's an opportunity which possibly the OEMs of the world have to start looking at.
I think they've already started looking at that.
Yes. So, and that is where I think our companies also now, because you know, it's just been what, 2 decades that we opened this to the private sector. I mean, I wish it was done say 20 years earlier to God, when we did it. By this time our companies would have been world leaders. I mean, because there is, in terms of the quality of work that they do, you know, yesterday I was in Bangalore and I met a company which is 80% of its total turnover is all exports. And when I asked them, it's a value for money, yeah, I'm competing with the rest of the world. I'm competing with the rest of the world, I provide value for money. There are people sitting here, 3 years back they had zero exports. Today they are competing with all the rest of the world and giving them value for money. People are coming to them for repeat orders. There is a company in metal injection molding in Bangalore, which is a world leader. And the second company after that company is almost 70% behind him. That's the kind of a lead which this company has. And I asked him a simple question, how are you a world leader? He said, my manufacturing processes, I think I'm a world leader because my manufacturing processes, my management systems, my skill sets are up world standard, and there's nobody who will match.
And at a fraction of a cost perhaps, so, of the competitor.
Absolutely. So I think that is where our industry now needs to leverage its strengths. And one good thing which has happened is to be honest with you, a lot of technologies are also getting opened up. DRDO has also opened its door to the industry. Great thing which has happened. mass services. I mean, I have seen this transition over the last 2 years. I mean, now you go to any incubator right now, thanks to the IDEX program, every day our services are, I mean, they have a huge risk. It's not their mandate to kind of create a manufacturing ecosystem within the country. But great thing is our services have taken it upon themselves that look, we'll defend the country on the one side, but at the same time we'll try and create this enterprise here. And you can find many of them going down to the incubators, explaining their problem statements. And you know, in IDEX now we have 44 winners who are working on trend-setting products. And by Def Expo, hopefully 10 to 15 would have actually crossed the stage where they are almost at TRL level 7, where they are just ready to be inducted. And all this is happening because there are nodal officers put in by the forces who are explaining to them what they require. And I think this kind of a cooperation and conjunction is a great launching pad for a lot of these futuristic technologies which are going to come out of this. And I think that is again a fundamental transformation which has happened. One more transformation which has happened is our whole attitude. You know, earlier if a business has an inquiry, they can't even get into the Ministry of Defence. I mean, our Honorable Raksha Mantri, the CEO's conclave, he said this. Look, as a country to defend, I'm not going to pass over any secret to you. And you can't meet me just like that. But doesn't mean that when an industry issue is there, I'm a fortress. He used the word fortress. I'm open, I'm available, my officers are available, go and tell them. We have all the exporters here. All the exporters now, we have created a small WhatsApp group. They have one particular application pending. They give a WhatsApp to us. We have now a portal, it's completely online. They send us digitally signed requests. We give them digitally signed authorizations. In that process also, we are now improving. Earlier, we had this requirement of end user certificate to be given to us in physical format. Now, we are going to tweak that. So, possibly for all the components now, in the morning they will apply for their permission and by evening they will get their permission. We will reduce this whole time
news.
From 15 days to even a day.
Great news.
So, that is also going to happen this month itself. We have already got the clearances done. And hopefully this is again going to help. In IT also I had realized, and this is what all the friends in the IT industry kept telling me, and I think Gurcharan Das also wrote that, why the IT industry performs well, because you know it works in the night, because people like us are sleeping during the day, during the night, so that is when they kind of, so it's important that bureaucracy and the government understands, and this is what we are trying to do now.
That's right.
The business of business is not to run around us. The business of business is to do business, and our business is to facilitate those businesses.
It's such
and that
a
is where we are trying to move our energies into.
Absolutely.
So, and then that is why coming back to the last point that you made about Def Expo.
Yeah.
And that is why we have kept fairly advertently, it is not inadvertent, the topic, the theme for this year's Def Expo is digital transformation of defense.
Absolutely. And what all the steps that you just mentioned are digital transformation.
And you know, digital transformation of defense is very important because now we don't, see it's like our country, we missed out on black and white TV, we missed out on a color TV, and I still remember there were countries where color TV was there, we never even had a color TV. For example, but as far as telecom is concerned, even if we missed out, we leapfrogged and went directly onto 4G. Our telecom networks currently, I mean, we've moved around the world and we know where we are. I mean, it's world class. We leapfrog. And I think in defense also now there is a need for our industry to leapfrog. Now you can't keep complaining and saying that, look, I am missed out on the artillery gun, so now I'm not going to produce an autonomous lethal weapon system. So we will leapfrog. We will use our existing skills. We'll forget about our past backlog. And this is the time when digital transformation of defense is going to take some of our companies. I mean, every company sitting right here has their own IT and they have their own collaboration with top IT companies in the country. And possibly that is where digital transformation of defense is going to be important. Also, not just for the production of weapon systems, but also to transform their own. Now, we have the industry 4.0 practices. Now, no industry can be competitive unless and until they imbibe the practices of industry 4.0, and all our industries are world class. I mean, you look at the manufacturing systems which the top companies have, they have the world class system, they have imbibed all the industry 4.0 practices, and it's important that we give those practices out.
That's right.
Last point that you mentioned about the MSMEs.
Yes.
I think that is one part that needs to be given a very close attention, and it's starting to, because you know, most of, If you look at the entire ecosystem that we have, out of $12 billion of total production that we have done in our country, honestly, 50% of it actually comes in from the MSMEs. All of us would know that our DPSUs or are all big players, they have a chain of vendors who are working behind them. We have in our database close to 8,000 MSMEs right now. We are in fact trying to work with those MSMEs, and we are trying to put out many programs. You yourself participated in programs where
yes.
And we have even come up with a scheme now wherein we are going to have exclusive programs for MSMEs, exclusive programs like this
for the tier 2 cities that
in
we are
tier 2 cities,
yeah.
tier 2, 3 cities. You have been helpful in getting those people around, and I think what is required for the MSMEs and is a system that is not just being followed for defense now, it's for the entire sector.
Right.
Now you have the 59th minute, they can open an account, they can accept their loans accessed. You have the discounting system for their bills, which is again very helpful. And importantly, what you require in the MSMEs and their energy is a system wherein the relationship with the primary player. Now, for example, the Lockheeds or the BAE and the Boeing and the Airbuses of the world, and all of them have a huge vendor base, and that vendor base is what is generating output for them. And I think that is what is going to give us the I always call them MSMEs are the pillars of any industrial production, and we need to specifically focus on them because they don't have deep pockets. They have fairly limited resources at their command.
Yes.
The only thing they have is the skill sets which are kind of niche.
That's
and to an extent, I think that's where.
And I think that's where you focus now. And I'm glad you actually spelled out the steps that have been taken. And I think the MOD and Mr. Jadhav deserve a round of applause here because. This is the enabling environment that will take the Indian defense industry much ahead and leapfrog, as you mentioned. But let me turn to Mr. Patil again, and because L&T is such a major OEM, Indian OEM, we have friends from foreign countries here. What should they look forward to Indian products? I mean, specifically, of course, L&T products, but generally, when you speak to them or when you approach them, and what should they will be approaching you for looking for some of the defense components as well as platforms.
When it comes to complete systems, obviously it's our experience that people want to know, did you really do it for your country? Nobody wants to buy the same thing though.
I see, they want additional value addition to it?
Absolutely, because everybody has his own specificities in terms of requirements, and he actually looks for, do you have something similar, but can you add something ABC to that? And that's exactly where the innovation and the track record one can actually leverage. So it's not pure innovation being sold, it's not pure track record being sold. It's something which is a combination which we found makes a huge amount of sense. And without naming a country or let's say our embassy, that place or whatever,
right.
We have had cases where a country says, I have a vessel, but I don't have a weapon system mounted. And if one was to look at, let's say, a naval, absolute frontline kind of a weapon ship, you can broadly put it under ASW, you can put it under surface-to-surface warfare,
right.
Or air defense warfare. Beyond that,
yeah.
Whatever one is talking about.
Sure.
Now, if a nation comes up and says, in this case, somebody said, I need this capability.
Yeah.
A specific capacity, I mean a capability which a nation is looking for, it's not there on the ship, or it's there something which is, call it a real old one that needs to be replaced.
Yeah.
Now, having done this for our armed forces for nearly 30 years now,
yeah.
That becomes something which you can very cleanly and clearly offer. Because when you are talking of exports being closed out in 3 months, there is no time to innovate, there is no time to develop.
They want it immediately.
What you actually can do is what you have, and you can then, within that period, be able to create that differential. That's something which that guy is looking at.
Sure.
And that's essentially where the focus is. What Sundar you said is actually right.
Yeah.
You need to have capabilities, and then only you can go and say, I need a clearance by today. Why it is today working is there is a pull, there is also a will. I mean, it's a combination of both, that there is a pull effect which is getting created.
And there should be a push also.
Yeah.
And there has to be a push also that, yes, I have an opportunity. Where there is a specific opportunity in terms of, one is talking of, let's say, foreign aid being given or a credit being provided, any of those kind of things obviously then get bogged down to the previously. We know that the clearance process used to be not even anything
you can count, because the RFP necessarily will have fallen apart.
That's right.
The idea of this game is, before the RFP comes in, can you close out a deal? And that's essentially where, and that's one area where I can say very clearly, our embassies and our DAs have actually been very useful.
That's right.
May not have happened to everybody, but at least for last 10-15 years, I know Larsen & Toubro is to that extent well known, well understood. And my largest shareholder always said, don't go by Larsen & Toubro's name, largest shareholder is Government of India. And I used to go and tell an ambassador at that place that you are my largest owner, why don't you come, let's carry the flag and make a sale happen.
So good combination, actually. Yeah.
So that's essentially where it's not me, it's not the person concerned or the officer concerned. It's something which we need to do as a kind of a joint effort for a nation to get into an export.
Absolutely. So it's a joint collaboration and cooperation, that's where it comes in. And with so many of the foreign friends here who are here, they have lots of requirements. And if the Indian industry grows the way it is growing in terms of technology, in terms of ease of doing business, I see no reason why they can't.
I see one more very, very important part, which obviously is happening. I'm not saying it's not happening. Today it's happening very focused, and since 2016, when this kind of a conclave actually began, it has created some differentiation. These are people, as we would see in industry, as your actually eyes and ears in that place. That there is a gap in capacity or a capability which is needed for that place, it's only the guy who is in market would know. It's not possible for industry at current kind of a scale to be at 45-50 countries, although Larsen & Toubro is benefited to the extent of we exist in about 48 countries today.
Yeah.
Scenario is, these are places where a DA actually listens ground, ear to the ground. If he passes on, today the scenario is there was a channelizing of this information, which used to happen, and that channelizing necessitated. Till 2 years back, virtually everything used to pass through MOD, and if it passes through MOD, read something between lines, it will only go to some select people, let me not say who, but select people, and obviously those opportunities are not available to industry at large.
Right.
Today there are processes which are evolving to the extent that because of these kind of conflicts, people know who has that capacity,
and
who has the capacity, who has a solution available, and to that extent, if that connect happens, you are going to be able to leverage that and make the deal happen very, very quickly.
I'm glad you say that, because for that, I think all our foreign friends deserve a round of applause for themselves, really, for doing this, because that's where the information flow both ways happens, and that's what I'm glad we have been instrumental partly to do this. But let me turn,
just to supplement what you said, you if you look at the board right there, it's one of the great things that has happened.
That's right. Right. So they, in fact, approached us.
So I think this is what it is. You needed this Indigenous Defence Equipment Exporters Association. I mean, this is one thing which are remarkable. I mean, this is what is required. This is how synergies are built.
Exactly.
I mean, companies all work in tandem, as bowlers bowl in tandem.
They do that. Yeah. You want to say something, General Assamis?
If I may just add, as an aside, in tandem with the one of the industry houses, organizations, the Army has prepared a consolidated document, a book, which gives out manufacturers of all types of equipment, defense equipment, and has been shared with all our DAs who are deployed in all countries across the world, for them to know what are the strengths of our industry, which they can showcase where and when they get an opportunity to do that. So that's where even the armed forces are contributing in enhancing our exports
in whatever little manner that we can.
No, no, I agree with you because till say 7-8 years ago when you went to a defense attaché, Indian defense attaché posted abroad, he would say, I am confused, I don't know whether it's my mandate to encourage Indian industry or not because it's not in my SOPs or my instructions. But today I believe it's now put in there.
Now we also have given budget now to all our defense attachés for doing all those activities and in our initial communication with the defense attachés, we have told them these are like private sector companies, these are Indian companies, they are not like you're trying to, you know, be hobnobbing with them, you're not doing all that, you're doing this as a purpose. I mean, when we interact with the industry, it's not as if I have a quid pro quo stuck with them.
No.
My job is to support them, and as if when you, and I think this is one credit to this department also, where we don't look at public sector as one and private sector as one. The level playing field has to be for both of them.
That's right.
Both of them have to compete to remain competitive, and I think defense attachés also have been, and this is what, and I can really compliment and congratulate our forces. Because the kind of energy our defense attachés are showing on matters when it comes. I mean, I have been part of two delegations last 15 days and all the private industry would confirm that both these delegations happened just because of the relentless persuasion and efforts put in by our defense attachés.
Yes, I think Mr. Patil has something to add.
Let me come in here on this point. Let me say that the peer-to-peer selling is the best selling.
Absolutely.
And that's essentially a role I see our armed forces actually carry. I'm not saying just now, but let me say some time back.
Yes.
I have actually seen this happen, and I went and thanked, let me not say who, let me not say what level, but I went and said thank you so much for actually telling the man in uniform on the other side that we have been taking it from Indian companies.
Right.
And we've been extremely happy, and it's not today's story, it's two decades of story.
Correct.
Let me tell you, we were able to go and close that deal in less than 3 months.
Oh wow, that's very encouraging.
And I said, went and said, sir, thank you very much, because when a man in uniform actually gives you an advocacy, that's the best sale you can actually clinch, because that's where the mother man actually sees the value coming out of.
Yeah, because he's a user.
He's a user from a user's perspective. To my mind, we need to have some amount of institutionalized process.
Right.
Today, this is out of goodwill, something may happen. Mm-hmm. But we need, what we actually see in most of the exporting nations is this one piece.
That's right.
We've done so much. We need to add, this is one piece I believe which can create a huge amount of differentiation. You talk to UK, there's a very specific organization. You talk of South Africa, you have a very specific organization. You talk of South Korea, you have a specific organization.
Right.
So each of these nations, for that matter even Israel,
yeah.
Now each of them have an organization which very clearly does this with a man in uniform who is available to actually explain, to sort of sell that deal kind of a scenario.
To the other side, yes.
To
the peers.
To do something major.
Yeah.
I'm one who is obviously conscious when I say this, that export is not something about selling a capability of a company.
It's about
it's not one. It's about nation. It's also about collaboration.
That's true.
Lots of our major exports, let me say at complete systems level and platform level, have happened not because it's only Larsen & Toubro.
Yeah.
It's Larsen & Toubro along with it carrying others.
Others, yeah.
Any of those kind of program, and although we are today not exporting, but the K9 Vajra story,
right.
We have 2200 MSME partners exactly. In that program.
Right.
So if let's say I do a next deal of 50 Vajras,
yes.
Which is under discussion today outside the country,
right.
It's the entire 2200 who get a continuity beyond the 100 which are by
which are with the Indian Armed Forces.
And that's essentially where we actually see a role for our own armed forces to the extent of pushing it on somebody, because the reach what our armed forces have, we have seen, because what CNS in the morning spoke about, we train our people out, we train their people here.
That's right.
Those are opportunities. We need to find some structured mechanism to be able to harness.
I think that's a food for thought which we can look
if
for.
If we do that, we can truly leapfrog, I think 35,000 crore what we are talking.
It's not an issue.
We can certainly cross.
Yeah. But let me turn to Kurt again for, you know, we are speaking about MSMEs quite a lot. And if I'm not mistaken, Lockheed Martin, like other bigger OEMs, foreign OEMs, has tried to rope in lots of MSMEs. You did mention in your first opening remarks about MSMEs. But give us an idea that what do you think the Indian MSMEs need to do to meet the standards of international global players?
So a good example of industries, I would like to use the example, we're working with Tata right now to manufacture the wing for the F-16, and hopefully when we win fighter competition, they will also be manufacturing F-21 wings, plus expanding that on to the entire airplane. We worked with Tata to kind of follow our model, and we let them use their model as well, and made a mix of how they are developing an ecosystem to build that wing. In my mind, that's an example of Make in India, where they are not only Tata, a very large company, is not the only company involved. They went out and they surveyed over 40 companies within India, around the whole country, to look as potential suppliers to work with them in building the wing. Eventually, they down selected to about half of that quantity. And so there is work around the country that is going to go into that wing. And there are a lot of MSMEs that are providing different detailed parts that will go into the assembly of that wing. So from my perspective, it is taking on a project. And to what Mr. Patil said, it's collaboration.
That's it.
It's working together to develop that skill set, to develop that capability, so where they can do it on their own without the OEM having to be involved. That's exactly what we want to do with our Make in India concept here in India.
I'm glad to see that. I have time for two questions if there are any. Two very pointed questions, otherwise I need to free some of these people. Here they have different appointments and we are eager to hear the next panelist, next set of panelists who are coming up there, in case there are questions. Anybody? No? Okay, I take it that they've given us such great... There is one, yes. Okay, 1 minute. Just coming there. Right at the end, please.
Just now, General said there is a book given to the DAs, those who are in abroad. Can we know the list of companies over there? Just we want to know whether our companies are listed over there in that book.
You need... No, I'll tell you. Okay, I got it. He says that the list of companies given to the DAs or the instructions given to the RDAs, Indian DAs abroad, can we know what is the list or can we share, can we have that? Is there a booklet that they can share? Or something that you can share?
Yeah, it's very much possible. The... ADB, Army Design Bureau, can be contacted. It can be shared with anyone who is interested in getting to know what are the industries that are available and what products are being manufactured in India.
And we also have this book. I'm carrying a hard copy. The soft copy of it is also available on our portal. This is our Indian Defense Industries. The entire book, in which includes all the platforms, not just on the public sector,
private as well,
as well as all the components and all those manufacturers who are in this particular list. This book is there with all the DAs as well, and this has also been given out to our embassies, and this has also been given out to all the foreign DAs.
Wonderful.
Right.
Yes, we'll do that. Yes, Professor Jagannathan from Central University, Jammu.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. It's so enlightening having a good composition of the speakers here.
Put your
hand. I have two brief questions. One is to the JS, when he mentioned about, he was, you know, giving them how the MOD has been dealing with this for almost 2 years. I would like to know about the FDI, 100% FDI defense sector. How do you assess that 3 years back, we have announced that the FDI in different sector, 100% FDI in different sector. and how far we have achieved in that sector? What are the challenges? Do you see any challenges, potential challenges in that that scheme? The last question to the NUST, when you mentioned about the F-16 compounds can be, you know, also been manufactured, do you think there is a potential in India to manufacture F-16 components in terms of, you know, PPP model under Making India project?
Yeah, you so coming to the FDI, yeah. So now let me first tell you that we in the government and the policy that we have right now, we are open to even 100% FDI in defense. My friend on my right can make note of it. We are open to having 100% FDI in defense with government approval. And earlier it used to be only for a very high technology stuff. But now if we can record a reason, we can permit 100% FDI in defense.
That's good news.
So I think that, I still get a feeling possibly this message has not really gone down. Because, you know, we have been talking to the OEMs, and they keep coming to us and tell us that, look, whether it is possible for us to set up a 100% owned subsidiary in India. Just as Microsoft has a 100% owned subsidiary in India, just as Google has, just as Facebook has, just as all the other companies or Amazon has. So I think it's possible for even the global OEMs in defense to set up a 100% subsidiary. Of course, when it comes to 49, it's an automatic route. But when it comes to 100%, you need to apply. But the application process has also become much, much simpler. Because the Foreign Investment Promotion Board has been abolished. The powers have been delegated to respective ministries. So to an extent, the entire process is fairly simple. But surprisingly, we have not really found lot of interest coming in from the global OEMs to use this particular facility which is available. Of course, there has been change in terms of the quantum of FDI that has been received. Just to give you a perspective, from 2001 till 2014, we had received FDI about 1500 crores for those 14 years.
Yeah.
From 2014 till 2019, we have received another 1400 crores. So it's again, what we did in the 15 years, we have actually been able to achieve in the last 5 years. So to an extent, there has been a good significant turnaround which has happened in FDI. But I think it's important that we attract more and more FDI for defense, because when it's going to come as an FDI route, it's also going to bring in not just capital, it's also going to bring us the knowledge, know-how, also allow our industry to become part of the global supply chain.
That's where I think Kurt's answer needs to be given to the gentleman there.
Yes. So the simple answer is yes. I think we're demonstrating that today by starting to manufacture the wing with Tata. If you look at our product, F-21, we have roughly over 400 different suppliers around the world. They're not just in the U.S., they're around the world that are manufacturing different pieces and parts of the airplane. We have stated that we are going to build an ecosystem here in India using the industries in India to manufacture the F-21.
Yes.
We are going to build that ecosystem, and I have confidence in the capabilities that we are seeing in the industries.
That's good to know, and on that note, I think I need to stop here and thank my co-panelist and do the honors for the panelist here from Bharat Shakti, and so that we move on to the next ones. Thank you very much, all of you, all three of you, for this wonderful insight into the Indian defense industry and the export promotion. A big round of applause for all of you. Thank you very much.